Monday through Friday, now twice a day here on the National Christian Network. And as always, Pastor Murray, it's an honor and a privilege to have you in our studio.
It's always a pleasure to be here, Ray, and just to share in fellowship with the family here at NCN.
Amen. You know, as we broadcast and we send out the Word of God, and you, of course, each day teach and explain, we know that not everybody picks up the time, a telephone, or even picks up, especially in our busy schedules, time to write. Have you heard from a lot of people?
Oh, we've made many, many wonderful friends by people calling in, people interested in studying God's Word. That's the purpose of my life, is to have people study His Word, and it seems that we've encouraged many to do that, and it isn't necessarily that everyone can agree 100%, but right. To study God's Word, for God has many purposes and duties for His children.
Okay. Tonight, you will field any question on the Scripture?
We'll sure have a go at it.
Okay. There you have it. What a challenge. Pastor Arnold Murray in our studio, and our telephone lines are now open. It's a toll-free number. It's on your screen. Let that phone ring until we answer it, and we do welcome your calls tonight. We're going to go right into our phones because this is so responsive to many of your requests, and I want you to take advantage of it, even if you disagree with him, by all means. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm getting some feedback, I think.
Okay.
Well, I think it'll be okay.
Where are you calling from, sir?
I'm calling from Plaquemine, Louisiana.
Yes.
And I want to tell Pastor Murray that I've received his newsletter, and I'm very impressed with his broadcast, and I really praise God for this brother who is boldly speaking the Word. And I received his Mark of the Beast tape, and I have listened to it. And I have one question on a scripture that he had brought in from the book of Genesis. And it's about Lucifer in the Garden of Eden. And I was wondering if he would clear up a question that I had about Eve somehow partaking of the forbidden fruit. And he said something about the seed of Satan being Cain. And I wish he would expound on that.
Okay. How about that for an easy first question?
How about that? Okay, it seems like that's the last subject we had when we were here, isn't it? Thank you for your comments. I appreciate that. I would like to address you to 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 2. I would like for you, if you have a strong concordance, to look up the word where Paul states, and he's talking to the Christian, he says, I want to present you to Christ as a chaste virgin, not as Eve, who was beguiled in the English. True. But the word in the Greek is expatio, and in your Strong's Concordance is the word number 1818. And you will find that it means to be wholly seduced. So I feel that, yes, that tree that she partook of, what is this is the trunk of your body. These are the limbs. Paul taught this. Jesus taught it in Matthew chapter 13, whereby he said, God created the field. He planted the good seed, which was his children, but an enemy came in the night. And he declares, not in the parable, but when he is explaining the parable, after verse about 35 or so, he states, he that planted the wicked seed was Satan, that old devil. And of course, then he continues on to the end and declares that the angels shall be the reapers that removes the tares, but we're to leave them alone. So, again, that question, we could speak for 30 minutes on it, but I would recommend you to check it out in that 2 Corinthians chapter 11. You will note in that chapter 11 also that following the comment that Eve was beguiled or wholly seduced, as it is stated in the Greek, not my words, but the words of Paul, that it is to be no marvel to anyone that this Satan, this tree, this body, should deceive anyone, for in the end times he will be transformed. Now, it's transformed in the English into an angel of light, but in the Greek it says he's coming disguised as an angel of light to deceive the world. I'll just give you a little home assignment on 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Okay?
All right.
God bless you.
Thank you for your call.
Thank you.
All right, bye-bye now. Good evening. You're on the air with Pastor Murray.
Hello.
Hi.
Calling from Southern California.
Yes, ma'am.
I believe that Pastor Murray is a very sincere man, and I hear him on occasion. One thing I do agree with him on are the two houses of Israel. And that's unusual for a Baptist to say that.
Well, who are you referring to as a Baptist, you or him?
Me.
Oh, okay.
Not many of my Baptist friends would agree with me on that point of theology, but I have been convinced.
Well, for the benefit of our viewing audience, what are the two houses of Israel?
The two houses of Israel, and thank you for that comment. I appreciate that. The two houses of Israel are the house of Judah and the house of Israel. Now, most Christians make the mistake of trying to cram all of Israel into one tribe. That's the tribe of Judah. It won't work. God promised, God ordained that Israel would become as numerous as the stars of heaven and the sands of the sea. Judah, by their own account today, in part, measure or number approximately 18 million. Now, that's not as numerous as the stars of heaven, but the fact is that the house of Israel, which after the Assyrian captivity from the land of Samaria, Samaria meaning Watch Mountain, they go over the Caucasus Mountains, settle Europe, and years later, many of them even migrating to this great nation, America, and God bless America, he does, because a large part of that, those other 10 tribes are located in this great nation, America, and the Christian nations throughout the world. And it is time that Christians wake up, and I do appreciate this sister, because this is a stand sometimes that draws persecution from other Christians when it's actually the true word of God. But it is real.
However, could I say that in believing that, it doesn't change my stand on dispensational theology one bit, because I feel that we are now in the age of grace, and we are going to be taken out of here by the rapture, which, of course, Pastor Murray vehemently disagrees with.
Right.
I believe that then God will take up his dealings with the two houses of Israel during the tribulation period. So, you see, I'm not totally convinced of your doctrine.
Very good. I feel that God has, it is everyone's right to and should study the scriptures and should definitely stay where they feel comfortable or where they feel that God has placed a conviction upon them. I would never attempt to pull someone from a persuasion as strong as yours. I respect you as a fellow Bible scholar and appreciate your comments.
Okay.
There's just one thing I wish that Pastor Murray would do, and that is I wish he would stress salvation by grace through faith alone in the Lord Jesus Christ. And I think that he doesn't stress that enough in his teaching.
Maybe he doesn't believe it. What is your position on salvation?
Where we teach, dear sister, chapter by chapter and verse by verse, usually I try to hold to the study we happen to be covering, but I do believe 100% in salvation. We just finished the book of Romans, and the 11th chapter of Romans has to do with why Israel more or less was blinded as to who they are, the fact we were discussing a moment ago, whereby through their being blinded, that salvation after Christ paid the price was open to all peoples by the grace, by his grace, by the hope and the faith that people put in him. I don't care who you are, if you believe upon him, you are saved in his grace. It is perhaps that I do stress because I'm trying to reach those children of Israel, to wake them up to that they must accomplish. Even, let me say, let's grant that if the church was gone, all right, allow me that, in a rapture, the children of Israel, 12,000 from each tribe, must still make a stand against Antichrist. That is my purpose in my teaching now, is to prepare that people for that duty. That is to say, witness against Antichrist, those 144,000. I'm not saying, or would I be presumptuous enough to assume I was the only one doing this? Certainly not. But God has aligned me in that direction. But this does not prohibit salvation by grace for all people. All praise Christ. He paid that price, and that price has been paid, and it is available for all.
Okay. Thank you very much for your call tonight.
You're welcome.
Bye-bye now. Good evening. You're on the air with Pastor Murray.
Oh, good evening again, Ray. I do so much appreciate this amazing Grace program, and particularly when Dr. Murray is on it.
Good.
I'm enjoying your Jeremiah series that comes on at 8 o'clock here in Wichita Falls, Texas.
Mm-hmm.
And I am enjoying your Acts series that we're catching at 6 o'clock here now. It's just a wonderful teaching.
Good. Well, how about
I'd want to make one comment. Dr. Richardson was on your program last week.
Yes.
And he was a very interesting man. And I quoted 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, and I read verses 1, 2, and 3. And it seems to me like the word is so clear on the fact that Paul was stating to the people in his letters and in his teachings that 2 Thessalonians surely did concern itself with the catching away of the church and meeting Christ and the fact that it's taught so strongly in the churches today. But it seems like hardly any ministers or Bible students ever get to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, which very clearly states that this catching away of the church to Christ shall not occur until Christ comes on earth. It's just not going to happen before Satan comes. It's not before the tribulation. We will go through the tribulation, and we will not be joined with Christ until the beginning of the millennium or right after the tribulation period.
Okay, I've got to ask Pastor Murray if he goes along with that. I just want to keep current here.
Yes, that
is your position.
Yes, very definitely.
Okay, mm-hmm. Go ahead, sir.
I forgot the other thought I had, but it wasn't too important. But I'll continue to listen and enjoy, Dr. Murray. Thank you so much, sir.
God bless you.
Thank you.
Thank you for calling. Bye-bye now. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi. This is David Elk.
Yes, Dave.
And I'm from Palm Springs, California.
Welcome to the broadcast.
I'd like to ask one question. We were reading in our Bible study, Dill, that Earth was created way before when Genesis wrote in the Bible about God brought, you know, made the earth, and then, but before he made it, because Lucifer was kicked out of heaven with a third of the angels. And what we're trying to decide is, when Lucifer was kicked out, that he was put on the earth, and Lucifer made it void, And then God came down and made the Garden of Eden, and then decided to put man in there.
Mm-hmm.
We were just wondering, because we've had a lot of commentary against cavemen and dinosaurs and this and that.
Just how old the earth is and what is God's word really trying to say? Well, I know that.
Yes.
I know that Pastor Murray has a...
Watch you every day.
Okay. I know Pastor Murray has a very strong position on that, and it's interesting that you should call with that question, because that was our alternative subject for tonight had we not started exactly following his Bible study. So why not give us a little insight as to your position?
The Spirit works in strange ways,
Amen.
Does he not?
Amen.
Yes, thank you for that question, and I'll address it if you like.
Please.
I would say your first place to begin actually is 2 Peter chapter 3, where Peter says, the reason I write this second epistle to you is to stir your minds up about what the prophets taught, meaning the prophets in the Old Testament, and the apostles of the New Testament, concerning Christ returning to this earth. That many will say, it's not going to happen. But he said, they are willingly ignorant of. Now, ignorant in the Greek is not as strong as it is in English. It simply means they don't know. But he says they willingly don't know. Why? They don't study God's Word. He said, willingly they are ignorant of the fact that before the earth was of old. And this word old means just that, old, that the mountains were standing out of the water. Now, the reason he makes that statement is because teachers, even at that time, and yes, this, claim that there was a void and the earth was covered with water, and that it was a void, tuhu in the Hebrew, which means completely desolate. Peter declares that that is not true, that it was destroyed by water. Now, in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, it states, in the beginning, which really is the name, God created the heavens and the earth, period. Now, it doesn't say when. It doesn't say address each. It does not address date at all. However, in verse 2 comes the answer in the Hebrew manuscripts. It states in the Hebrew that the earth then became void and without form, meaning that after Satan's first rebellion, God destroyed the earth age that was. And that ended an era. Now, to go deeper into this, you're in Jeremiah chapter 4, you will find that God, addressing the fact that he will, when his wrath builds in the end times, and actually Satan's second casting out, as recorded in Revelation chapter 12, he puts this as a challenge, more or less. He says, you know, he says, my people are sottish, which in the Hebrew simply means stupid. My people are stupid. They won't study the word. They have no wisdom, and they are very quick to do wrong, but not to do right. For they don't know, and must know, that I destroyed this earth one time before. I destroyed it to the point, again, vuhu, tuhu, rather, meaning complete. There was not one man. Now, we know in Noah's flood, there were eight souls on the ark alone. And he said there was no birds, there was no vegetation. We know at Noah's time, Noah sent forth a bird, a dove, and this dove brought back an olive branch. Of course, we're talking about two different floods. The thing that upsets me in this is it drives many thinking people away from Christianity when they hear ministers declare and make a stand, this earth is 6,000 years old. Now, this turns people away from Christ and the study when they hear a supposed learned man making a statement like that, when a geologist or the science community can prove that this earth is millions of years old, and rightfully so. God's word states that it is millions of years old also. But there was the world that was, as Peter mentioned in 2 Peter chapter 3, as it is mentioned in Jeremiah verse chapter 4, as it is mentioned in Isaiah chapter 45, where God said, I did not create this earth void and without form. I created it to be inhabited by my people. It was that Satan's first fall caused him to either one of two things, destroy his children or destroy the age. Create a new heaven and earth and tell Adam and Eve to replenish, not to plenish, but to replenish. That means, again, populate the earth. Make a note of Jeremiah chapter 4 and understand that there were cities before that were destroyed in a different dispensation, but a very interesting study. Thank you for that question.
Okay, maybe Pastor Murray will be dealing with that subject in length on one of your upcoming series.
Yes, we'll do that.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you for your call, sir. Bye-bye now.
Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yes, I was calling to make a comment about the nation of Israel being split.
Yes.
What he had said, that's found in 1 Kings, the 12th chapter, where the nation Israel was split with Rehoboam, 10 tribes, which are commonly referred to as the lost tribes, went their own separate ways, made idols and sacrifices in the city of Dan. Two tribes, which became known as Judah, were the remaining two tribes of Israel. was carried away into Assyrian captivity. As the pastor said, the tribes of Judah was carried away into Babylonian captivity in three different carryings. 606 to 596. There they stayed for 70 years. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay, the second thing is, he had made the reference to 144,000 from the tribe of Israel, and that would be 12,000 from each tribe. There's only 10 tribes to the tribe of Israel and 2 tribes to the tribe of Judah. So 12 times 10 is 120,000. There's a mistake and a mathematical error.
Okay.
If we turn to 1 Peter 2, chapter 9, we'll see that the nation of Israel now is a spiritual nation. It said basically the same thing that God said to Abraham 4,000 years or however long ago. It says, you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God. And here God is telling, through Peter, that Christians themselves are the chosen people, that this is the tribe of Israel now, its spiritual kingdom. Is this your belief?
In part, yes. I would say that the two tribes, Israel and Judah, will be joined back into one stick. It's recorded in Ezekiel chapter 37. They will be joined back into one stick before that great day of the Lord. There will be harmony between those that do hear. At the same time, through salvation, this adoption, Christ set the example, and many overlooked that example of adoption in his genealogy that is listed in the first chapter of Matthew. The genealogy listed in the first chapter of Matthew is not Christ's genealogy, but Joseph, Mary's husband. Almighty God was his father. But it shows that Mary, being a cousin to Elizabeth, who was a daughter of Aaron, which made her a Levite, being both Levite and Judah, that we see he was, through adoption, through that son, all people come into that oneness. We read in Revelation chapter 21 that we see the four walls, for with three gates on each wall, meaning the 12 tribes. God made an eternal, everlasting covenant with them that shall not be broken. But what do we see coming in the distance? We see nations, which in the Greek is ethnos, meaning we Christians that have, through adoption, simply through grace, accepted salvation, are coming there in oneness to worship Almighty God. So yes, there is no difference, and yet there is. God's word shall be fulfilled to the letter. But as far as steps or levels of importance or prestige, there are none.
Okay, before we let you go, sir, where are you calling from?
Michigan.
From Michigan.
Hi.
Thank you for your call tonight. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi, this is David Duck again from Palm Springs. We have a Bible study, and I'm the spokesman. The other question I had was, the sons, the daughters of God mated with, the sons of God mated with the daughters of the earth, and created giants. Could you have Honor Murray explain that to us? Because that's the other thing that I just asked you about, the earth being created before Adam was.
Okay.
Please.
How big is your Bible study?
How big is it?
Yeah.
We belong to the Victory Christian Center in Palm Springs.
Wonderful.
And the Bible study we just started is at the trailer park, about 5 families, and now we're getting bigger.
Well, I think it's great.
Sure.
Every time we search the scriptures and study the word, that's where spiritual growth can take place, and I'm for that. Pastor Murray, the question.
Praise God. That's a wonderful question.
Thank you very much.
We were just speaking of Satan. Satan knew that Christ would come through the woman. Therefore, it was in this attempt to contaminate the seed of the woman that Cain was born. He failed in that attempt, but he made another effort inasmuch as he sent some of the sons of God. Now, you will never hear the term in that world that was, we were speaking of a moment ago, the daughters of God. There were no daughters until God created in this flesh age. Their souls were there, but we were one and the same there. So the female was a new creation by God. The sons of God observed the daughters of Adam. They were the daughters of Adam. They saw that they were fair and beautiful to look upon or desirable. And they left their first habitation, which means God had decreed all, every soul shall pass through this earth, born of woman, one time. These angels, as and actually that's what they were, angels, and Nephilim in the Hebrew, from the base root Napha, meaning fallen, fallen angels. And they took them to wife, they conceived, and where there is no mistake, even in the English, children were born, and they were Geber, or giants. They were misfits. They were not part of God's creation. It was for this reason that God brought about the flood of Noah, was to again free the woman from Satan's influx. The giants were moved, with the exception of another small influx, which I will not go into at this moment, but they were cleared. Jesus himself in Matthew 24 stated, do you know what? It's going to be just like this when I return. It's going to happen again. Meaning, in Revelation chapter 12, Michael is going to throw Satan and his angels, the Nephilim, back to this earth. He says, rejoice, O heavens, but woe, woe be to those on earth. For Satan is with you. This is his second advent, so to speak, if you like. This time, to persecute the woman who had the man-child that fled into the wilderness. Meaning, again, the woman's seed. Israel, whether by adoption and or otherwise, to destroy that woman, to overcome and gain the victory. But praise God, people knowing that they must combat and stand against this one will overcome him. This is said in a spiritual sense in the second influx, though. This is why Jesus made this statement in Matthew 24, woe to those that are with child and that give suck when I return to the earth. Meaning this. Meaning, he is our husband. If he has been gone, or if he has been away for 2,000 years, and he returns and finds us carrying a small suckling child, what does it mean? In a spiritual sense, it's obvious we worshipped Antichrist. We took on a false husband. This is also what Paul meant in his letter concerning a woman should keep herself covered because of the angels. These are the angels he was talking about to keep her head covered in church. Now, of course, we know that people that are strong in Christ do not have to fear this. Yet Paul and the others mention it as a reminder. Those angels in the book of Jude are locked in chains. For judgment they shall all die, as it is recorded in Revelation chapter 11, on that day that the two witnesses rise from the streets of Jerusalem. Okay? Thank you very much for calling in, sir.
Thank you very much.
All right, bye-bye now. If you're just joining us, our guest tonight, and by the way, this is a special program because it's just crossing the hour, and some of our stations are just now joining us. This is Ray Cassis on the National Christian Network, and you're in the middle of a program called Amazing Grace. Tonight we have a special guest in our studio, Pastor Arnold Murray, who is the conductor of the Shepherd's Chapel television program. And tonight we started right after his regular teaching series and came on live, and we're on right now live taking Bible questions on any Bible topic that you've heard Pastor Murray teach on, or even if you haven't heard him teach on it. We welcome your comments and your reactions and your questions tonight. We have a toll-free line. If you let that phone ring until we answer it, we'd like to get your reaction. Many of our viewers have asked for us to have a program like this where we can see Dr. Murray and pick up a phone and call him and say, I heard you preach or teach on such and such, and I got a question for you. So that's what we're doing here tonight, and I'm so happy again to invite you back to this second half hour of our program Amazing Grace to be with us live.
It's always a pleasure, Ray, to be with you and the family.
Amen. Let's go to our phones. The number is on your screen. If you'll give us a call, we do welcome your comments and questions. Pastor Murray in our studio live, taking your Bible questions from his teaching series or on any subject that you so desire. Hello, you're on the air.
Hello, this is the Baptist calling back.
We have double callers tonight, huh? Okay.
I have a question that I meant to ask Dr. Murray. It's about the 35th chapter of Jeremiah where it talks about the Rahabites. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly, but I think Pastor Murray will know what I'm talking about. Anyway, the Lord commends these people because of the fact that they had obeyed their father for many generations and had refused to drink wine. And the last verse of that chapter says, "Therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, Jonadab, the son of Rahab, shall not want a man to stand before me forever." But I find that in 1 Chronicles, the 2nd chapter and the 55th verse, that these Rahabites are descendants of the Kenites. And now Pastor Murray's teaching is that these Kenites are the descendants of Cain and that they are the seed of Satan. So my question is, how could God so honor these people in the 35th chapter of Jeremiah who are descendants of Cain?
Boy, there's a woman who really follows your teaching and double checks you on everything.
Right, I admire her. This is the idea that we as Christians study God's Word. That's an excellent question, and I'd love to address it. In 1 Chronicles chapter 2, verse 55, you will note that this verse, which is the final verse of that chapter, is tagged on to the genealogy or the chronology of Judah. But you will note, it says, and these are the scribes that were with Judah, that were with him, and mentions these various tribes of the Kenites and their father, Rahab. Kenite, in the Hebrew tongue, it's very easy to take a Strong's Concordance and look that word up. It simply means sons of Cain. So the manuscripts call them the sons of Cain. It is not myself that is calling them that. Now, the 35th chapter of Jeremiah is a fascinating chapter. I find it that way. Israel would not obey God. So he tells Jeremiah, you go out and get some of the sons of Jehonadab. Jehonadab in the Hebrew tongue meaning Yahweh greatest. So in a sense, the word is almost blasphemous within itself. And that not really answering the question, but I just add that in passing. You will have to be very careful. God throws another stone in the way for stumbling if you're not careful. He mentions through these children of Jehonadab that Jeremiah is brought in. But this is not the Jeremiah we know who was sent forth of God, chosen before birth, even before he was in his mother's womb, but a Jeremiah of the Kenite sons. You can check, it makes an interesting study. But God so admired them because they were vagabonds. They didn't plant seed, the curse that was placed upon Cain. They obeyed their father to the letter. And God promises them that because, he said, I only wish that my children were as true to me as you are to your father. And for this loyalty, I will see to it that you never have to want for a man to stand before you, which simply means you will never have to want for a strong leader. And they don't. God keeps his promises. But this simply fulfills or aids in fulfilling the negative part of God's plan. It makes an interesting study, that 35th chapter of Jeremiah. I admire your scholarship. I really do.
Okay. Thank you for your call.
Welcome.
Bye-bye. Getting a lot of good questions tonight. We'd like to give other people a chance to call in, so let's try to limit, just call in once if you can. Hello, you're on the air.
Hello. I'm calling from Rhode Island.
Yes, sir.
And I would like to know, on one of your last programs with Pastor Murray, he mentioned something about homosexuality.
Yes.
And I was wondering if he could expound on that.
All right. That was a very controversial program and a very controversial position. And I was waiting for someone to call right in. And what about the homosexuality that you found in Genesis?
Okay. Actually, I think in discussing it directly, we lose sight of what God would have us gather from it. To say a homosexual act as we think of it today, it is not written that happened. It simply states that Adam partook of the same fruit that Eve did, which was Satan. Now, there are many ways to defile oneself without committing an act of homosexuality between male and male. As far as God is concerned, a touch, I would not want to go into more detail and nor find that it would prove the point. I would also state that in Romans chapter 1, God declares the creation of old, where they left, that was unseemly. So naturally, Satan practiced, according to Romans 1, or instigated or promoted sin, yes, even to this point. And I feel that it does not necessarily, I think we lose sight of the point of what actually happened in the garden if we were to concentrate on that a great deal. Number one, many Christians would not look further to addressing the actual outcome. That is the negative part of God's plan. These acts simply happen, as the dear lady in the question before addressed Jeremiah 35. It allows the Christian today to trace those that propagate and bring forward the negative part of God's plan. Were we to concentrate on these acts of vulgarity, then we would lose sight of the very den within which Satan, Lucifer, works, and we would lose the richness and the wealth. For how could you know the mark of the beast, where to look for it? That mark of Cain was placed for a purpose whereby all down through history, in the Hebrew, you can trace he and his children. Not that we're to hate them. I do not want anyone to accuse me of teaching hate. God said, love your enemies. He said, love your children also. You correct your children. You do your enemies the same way. But God must have a negative part to his plan, else his prophecy could not come to pass. Example, how could we have one worldism were it not for the negative part of the plan and God in control, moving or allowing, whichever you prefer, to bring these points in time and in place whereby the Christian today, using that roadmap of genealogies, again, not to hate and not to make an issue of, but to be aware of the conspiracy of Satan in these end times, okay?
Is that to say that all homosexuals who are Christians doomed to the pit?
Oh, no, I did not say that. No, please, that's not indicated at all. I was simply saying if we were to put our eyes upon the act rather than the point that was expressed and brought forward, we would lose sight of what God wanted us to lose sight of, and that was simply the footprints to the negative part of his plan. Someone that has inclinations or is drawn to a certain thing, probably 99 times out of 100, or it's very possible, would not even be connected with Cain. Therefore, you would lose the actual meaning, if you would, of God's scripture in addressing the subject in the first place, okay?
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right, before I let you go, you had a question that my little flag went up. The gentleman asked you if Christian homosexuals were headed for the pit. Do you find the word Christian and homosexual to be in harmony with the Word of God?
It is not. Most ministers would immediately say, knowing that he would offend some by saying they're going straight to hell, you know. Now, they're not. Rather, knowing if he did not say that. I cannot say that because God didn't make me a judge. God alone can judge, and you know something? It states very clearly in Romans that if I were to judge someone that was a homosexual, that I would be I would be far worse off myself as a sinner before God, that were it a sin. I know many people, due to pollution, due to, I don't want to go too much into health foods or anything of this nature, by eating certain foods that were brought forth. I'll mention one, margarine of the old type. It is scientifically being proved. I'm not an authority in this. I want to make that clear before I go one step further.
that it does change the makeup of both male and female to a certain point. And I know that we are in a time when, with the world polluted, that people have different natural or feel, whether it is the mix-up of the pollution or what, or drawn naturally, where they normally, according to God's nature and act of things, would not be. So I certainly am not going to set myself up as a judge. You will never hear me teach in the negative. You will only hear me say, take on Christ, and if he gives you a conviction, you come out of it. But let him help you. Man cannot strengthen you. Christ can. Teach positive, and evil will fall to the side.
Okay. Do you consider yourself a Christian homosexual?
Yes.
Well, I would love to interview one on this program and get your views. Of course, the night would not be a good night, but if there's a... Are you a pastor by any chance? Or?
No, I am not. I'm just confused because a lot of homosexuals who are Christians believe in Christ, mm-hmm. and I guess we don't feel as though we're doomed.
Well,
that's where my confusion comes in.
I see. This is a very interesting subject, and I certainly want to deal with it on this program. We have had one guest who dealt with homosexuality. I don't know if you caught the program that particular evening.
No, I didn't.
But, of course, he was not positive about homosexuality, but quite negative. And I think, in all fairness, we have to open our chair up here, our hot seat, so to speak, to someone who is from the homosexual Christian community, although I must confess it's hard for me to say that, but if you know of someone who can handle the Word of God and who can represent your particular position, I sure would welcome opportunity to talk to him and have our audience participate in questions and comments. Okay?
Okay.
Could I give one follow-up?
Certainly.
On that? Never let man put you on a guilt trip. God is your judge, not man. I'm not approving or disapproving of what you're doing. I hope you understand that.
Pastor Murray.
Yes, sir.
I feel as though myself and many of homosexuals like me are of the elect. But that doesn't erase the fact that I am a homosexual. And that causes me a lot of confusion.
As I stated, do not let the confusion be placed upon you by man, where it would become a sin, certainly, is if you were to force or attentions or style of life on other people. All right?
Right, I agree with that.
Now, that I would have to say... outright, straightforward, that would be wrong.
I agree.
But we all have problems. And actually, who is to say, we have a saying in the South or in Oklahoma and other places that never judge a man unless you walk in his moccasins for 3 days. Well, I'm not saying that I can understand your problem at all. It would be impossible for me to totally understand from within your mind, understand what I'm saying. That's the only way you can help someone, if you can actually enter their mind and understand them, think as they would think. But the main thing is, I don't care what sin it is. Were we to call it a sin, and I'm saying this, please listen. God has stated there is only one unforgivable sin, and that is to deny the Holy Spirit an opportunity to speak through them. That opportunity will not become available until the elect are delivered up before Antichrist, and you are told to not premeditate what you'll say beforehand, but it will be the Holy Spirit that speaks through you. One with full knowledge that refused that would be doomed. Until that time, I say pray, seek Christ, read his scriptures, study his scriptures, let Christ place the convictions upon you, not man. Okay?
I will continue. Thank you, Father, Pastor Murray.
Thank you.
Thank you for calling.
Thank
Bye-bye. And do let me hear from you sometime if you can find a representative.
Okay, thank you very much.
Bye-bye now. Well, all the lines are jammed. We did it now. Hello, you're on the air.
Pastor Murray, this is Jacques Reed from Boston.
From Boston, yes.
I would like to make a point out of Genesis chapter 1, verse 20. And I know Pastor Murray had this on his mind, his thought. And God said, let the waters bring forth abundantly the moving creatures that have life. And that word in the Hebrew is nephesh, which means soul. And you said that it could have been the Chinese race that was created before Adam. And I just want to share a little mystery with you. And you know that Cain had got kicked out of the garden, and he went on the east of Eden, the land of Nod. And Nod means wandering. Well, there's a TV program that comes on that shows this Chinese man walking across deserts and into different towns, and his name is Cain. I just want to share that with the people.
Well, that's fine. I believe you said this is Jacques speaking.
Yeah.
Jacques, it's a pleasure having you call in. This Jacques is a student of God's Word. He is he's a fine student. Thank you, Jacques, for sharing that.
Thank you for calling.
Okay.
Bye bye now. Hello, you're on the air.
Yes, I was quite surprised with this homosexual on there. God clearly states in His Word that homosexuality is an abomination. And they also call it homosexual drugs.
Okay.
Right?
Any comment on that, Pastor?
It is true that God states that it is wrong. But it is not. When someone is searching Christ and when someone is trying, none of us have a right to say, you're doomed to hell, when they are trying. They have to be given hope. And that hope comes from the Word of God and studying His Word and Christ providing the convictions. As long as God is dealing with His elect, He takes them many places they know not where to go for many reasons. If we believe in election, we must let God control. Everyone knows, it has been taught since we were children up, that it is an abomination because it's taught as an abomination in the Word of God. But yet, He states, you shall not judge them, meaning anyone. So, as long as someone wants to study Christ's Word, no one has a right to prohibit or to limit their trying as long as the hope in Him is there, because I believe with all my heart that Christ is able to accomplish anything.
Okay. Thank you for your call.
He said that if he's a Christian, he puts on Christ, and the old man is dead. Now, if he puts on Christ, Christ does not tolerate, if he's a Christian, that type of lifestyle. And no use fishing around about it. It's either wrong or it's right. If it's in Christ, it's wrong. He's not in Christ if he's practicing that. That's what I'm getting at. God calls him both.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much. Well, bye bye now. Good evening. You're on the air.
I guess there are a lot of perfect people out there tonight, huh? Anyway, I just heard you talking about the sons of God and the daughters of men.
Yes.
And I've known about the seed of the serpent for some time. I've been studying it.
Mm-hmm.
And I always thought that the key being in the seed, that the sons of God and the daughters of men were two seeds.
Were two seeds. Pastor Murray, do you go along with that?
Well, yes, definitely. The seed that was, in other words, there would have to be two seeds before a child could be born, which were the giver or the giants from this, yes. But you see, the sons of God came to this earth outside the woman's womb. In other words, they were not born of woman. So it was a seed that was prohibited, Christ Himself making the claim. What was the sin they were doing before Noah's flood and it brought it about? Again, Matthew chapter 24, where Christ stated, when I return, it's going to be like it was in the days of Noah, where they were both giving and taking in marriage, you see. A marriage that is prohibited by God. which is to say a marriage between Nephilim, someone that leaves their first habitation and comes to this earth, a supernatural entity, and impregnates woman and brings forth a Geber, which is an off-thrower and hybrid. This would destroy God's plan, his very purpose for the second earth age, is whereby each soul that he created in the beginning would have an opportunity to pass through this earth age, flesh age, born to woman, to make his or her mind up as to whether they would love Christ or love Lucifer. That's the whole plan. That's why he cannot allow the supernatural or the hybrid to come in, whereby it would destroy the innocent, that is to say the flesh person, whereby our knowledge is so limited compared to the almighty grace of God. The supernatural has that knowledge, so it would destroy God's plan, and God's plan shall not be altered. He will correct. That's why he brought about the flood. Okay, where are you calling from, ma'am?
Melbourne.
From Melbourne. Thank you for
putting it. I thought, though, that the two seeds, the seed of Cain and the seed of Adam, were the seed of God. You know, Adam and Eve would produce the offspring that were both of the original creation of God for the human race. And then that it was so contaminated by the seed of the serpent that the flood had to be brought about because man's hearts were continually evil.
Mm-hmm. That serpent seed doctrine is along the line of Brennan's teaching.
I think so. Yeah. I would say, dear sister, if you were to read Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, God said to the serpent, I put enmity between thy seed and her seed. So it was the serpent's seed, not God's seed. Of course, if we were to take it to the ultimate, then we would have to go automatically to Ezekiel chapter 28, where God said, I'm the father of Satan.
If you take it to the virgin birth, then you find that was her seed.
That was the woman's seed, yes. That woman's seed was kept pure, though, not to be contaminated by Satan, by Lucifer. This is why that Eve was the mother of all living, because through her offspring to Mary came Christ, and in him we all have life, regardless of who we are. I would recommend, this is a quite an in-depth study within itself. If you have not had my work on the Mark of the Beast, we make a free gift of it to anyone that calls. I would certainly recommend it to you and would be glad to send it to you if through the program you would call for it.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you for calling. Bye-bye now. Hello, you're on the air. Good evening. Okay, we missed that one. Hello, you're on the air.
Hello, Ray.
Yes, sir.
I was listening for the TV to sound off. I'm calling from North Carolina.
Yes, welcome to the program.
I would like to say to Pastor Murray, I appreciate you very much, the way you boldly teach the word. I wish there were more pastors on the air and out here that teach the word the way you do. I listen to you every day. I don't miss a day.
Oh, that's tremendous. Thank you, sir. God bless.
One thing I would like you to explain to me why you do it, I'll go ahead and hang up and somebody else can call. But how do we come about our different races? And I thank you for your answer.
Okay. The origin of the races, Pastor Murray.
Thank you. The origin of the races is of course set forth in the beginning. This is one of the reasons I like to set forth tools for people to study by. Jacques, the student of God's Word that called a few moments ago, mentioned the 20th verse in that first chapter of Genesis. In a sense, this is what he's touching on. In the English, it states that God took minerals from the sea and created a living creature. We're all living creatures, understand. And gave it life, it says in the English. Most all good King James versions, if you check it to the index, you will see that that is soul. gave it a soul. So what we have, whether Adam was made from the clay, this entity was made from the minerals of the sea. Minerals are the same. I do believe this is why. And there's no grades, no steps. God, if he creates someone, it's perfect, it's beautiful, it's good. I certainly teach boldly also against someone apologizing for how God created them. That in itself would be a sin of sins. Or someone trying to be like someone else is to say, I would try to be like an Oriental, or an Oriental to be like me. That is not God's way. God had a perfect plan, and he created the various races for various reasons. Someday I hope to do a study on the world that was. Then we will understand. I want you to find in part, also, he created a man on the sixth day. He rested the seventh day, and then he created the man. So there were many races, but at the end of, what is it, chapter 2, he looked upon all he had created and saw that it was good. And we see in Revelation, again, I mentioned earlier, 21, where the ethnos, the Gentile people that have overcome completely, that are in the eternity, come with the family and worship the Almighty God. So God created people for a purpose, to fulfill his plan. Someday we'll totally understand. He touched on this real heavy in Romans chapter 9.
Unfortunately, we have to take a break now, but I hope he started to answer your question anyway. I hope he got to enough answered so for you to understand. Thank you for calling tonight. Oh, he hung up. That's right.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I'm waiting for him to say goodbye. Pastor Murray, we have to go in about another 10 or 15 seconds. We'll be right back. Can you stay with us another half hour, hopefully?
Yes.
Okay.
Be happy to.
For those of you along the line, we'll be right back. Stay on the lines. We'll be with you with Pastor Arnold Murray and more Bible questions as we present him to you tonight live in response to many requests we've had to have him come to our studio and talk to you live. And so here's your opportunity. Time. Mm-hmm.